Major funding for Frontline is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Additional funding is provided by this station and other public television stations nationwide.
Tonight on Frontline, the scene, Los Angeles, 1977. A frightening series of murders by the Hillside Strangler. One suspect, an all-American boy.
I've always wanted to go to California, a son, the girls, the beaches, the dream.
The kid I knew couldn't have ever hurt anybody or killed anybody.
This one I killed. This was the first one I killed.
The question, is he insane?
I was quite convinced that he was a full-fledged multiple personality.
I believe that he is playing a role and playing a part.
Through court-ordered videotapes, we examine with the experts the terrifying psychology of a killer, the mind of a murderer.
From the network of public television stations, a presentation of KCTS Seattle, WNET New York, WPBT Miami, WTVS Detroit, and WGBH Boston, this is Frontline with Judy Woodrow.
Good evening. As unpleasant as it is to hear, the Justice Department says there is a new breed of killer stalking the country. Called serial murderers, they kill for pleasure, moving around the country, killing for months or even years. The FBI has over 30 investigations underway involving possible serial murderers. Tonight on Frontline, you can journey with psychiatric experts as they probe the mind of one of these killers, Kenneth Bianchi, the man who came to be called the Hillside Strangler. Bianchi was a polite, clean-cut, seemingly all-American boy. But he was involved in the rape and torture murders of at least 10 Los Angeles women and two more in Washington State. After his arrest, he took on the behavior of a multiple personality, and four experts concluded he was insane. But was he? Frontline has obtained exclusive access to over 60 hours of the videotaped jailhouse interview with Bianchi. So it is possible for us to see some of what the experts saw as they made up their minds about this man. The program, originally broadcast last year, is produced and directed by Michael Barnes. And a warning, there are brief but graphic photographs of the victim's body, as well as strong language.
Well, I came there hoping to find a better job. I've always wanted to go to California, the sun, the girls, the beaches, the dreams, think of the smog and the crazy city.
Our story begins in September 1977, 3 years after Kenneth Bianchi's arrival in Los Angeles.
This is KFWB News. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Vince Campagna. Here's the latest news at noon. Geneva talks on a test ban of nuclear weapons is stalemated by the three major powers, the United States, Britain, and Russia. KFWB's Jim Mitchell will report on the discovery of a nude woman's body found in the La Crescenta area and the ongoing investigation.
The forecast for Los Angeles is going to be a beautiful weekend. It's a high tomorrow of about 77 degrees.
Glendale police have another apparent murder of a young woman on their hands. KFWB's Cecilia Pedroza has a direct report from Chevy Chase Drive.
Another young woman has been found in the Highland Park area. I repeat, the body of another young woman has been found in the Highland Park area.
Since Sunday morning, the bodies of three other young girls aged 12, 14, and 20 have been found within a few miles of this spot. All of the killings have occurred within the past 4 weeks, all 10.
Members of the Hillside Strangler Task Force are trying to trace the last movements of a young Glendale woman, now listed as the Hillside Strangler's victim.
Most of the Strangler victims were found in the hills surrounding Los Angeles, often near freeways or in ravines. The victims were mostly teenagers and young women.
I wish I could come here and give you some good news. Unfortunately, I cannot. Apparently, he is very good. He has certainly not left us the kind of evidence that we would need to make a direct connect of. If he had, we would have him in jail today.
Identikit pictures have so far failed to produce useful leads. Police psychologists believe he has a compulsion to repeat the crimes, and he will kill again.
This city was completely in the grip of the Hillside Strangler. We spent hour after hour, night after night, right here in Hollywood. Hollywood is not what most people think of it, or as it's portrayed in movies. We were talking to people that, with no names, prostitutes, male and female, street people, people that were loaded, didn't know if it was daylight or dark. And because of that, we got a lot of false leads and a lot of bad information. Well, we had theorized early in the investigation the possibility of someone that had some police training or background or was familiar with police tactics.
We were forced to tell our citizenry not to stop for a police officer on a side street, to go to a lighted area, particularly young women. Go to a lighted area or drive to a police station. The police would follow them and wait to talk to them at that location, because we felt it was too dangerous with this information in our possession to allow our citizenry to stop on the side streets for our officers.
Perhaps the most appalling in this series of murders was the murder of the two little girls. Dolly Cepeda and Sonia Johnson were 12 and 14 years old. These girls were considered good girls, family girls. They were not girls of the street. When they came here on Sunday afternoon, their families expected them to be safe. This shopping center is guarded, and it's in a safe area. We didn't have any idea where they went, where they were killed, who took them. We had no witnesses. We had no physical evidence, and all we had was, 8 days later, we found the nude, raped bodies of these two young girls on a hillside not far from here.
All the victims had been raped and strangled to death. They included 19-year-old Yolanda Washington, 15-year-old Judith Miller, 21-year-old Lisa Caston, and 20-year-old Christina Weckler, 14-year-old Sonia Johnson, 12-year-old Dolly Cepeda, 28-year-old Jane King, 18-year-old Lauren Wagner, 17-year-old Kimberly Martin, and 20-year-old Cindy Hudspeth.
What was so frightening about the Hillside Strangler was that the picture I had in my mind was of the average, ordinary man, someone that could be my colleague in the office, someone that could be waiting on my table in a restaurant, taking my tickets at the theater. He was not going to be a monster. He was going to fade into anonymity among all the other people. He was going to be somebody's loving son, loving husband, sweet brother, good neighbor. People were going to be surprised when we found out. And that was really frightening, because you didn't have a way to guard yourself, to protect yourself, because it could have been anybody.
And then the murders stopped. 10 women had died in 5 months. They appeared to be perfect crimes. There were no clues. Almost 150 detectives had conducted the biggest manhunt in the history of Los Angeles. It failed, and the killer or killers remained at large. But as the weeks passed, there were no more murders, and the city began to relax. Nearly a year later, two young women, university students, were reported missing 1,100 miles north in Bellingham, a small lumber and fishing center just below the Canadian border in the state of Washington, a town with just six detectives.
Go ahead, sir.
Bellingham police. Missing from where?
The girl reported missing to us was Karen Mandick. We then contacted her boyfriend, and he told us that she had received a job house sitting. This would be when a person goes away for some reason and leaves the house vacant, security agencies here in the city of Bellingham will have people come to the home and stay in the home for a period of time, like to an hour, while they put in security alarm systems or something on this order. She was to receive $100 for this hour's work. With her at the time, she took her roommate, Diane Wilder. We contacted the security agency, and the person in charge of this particular house sitting told us that he did not know Karen or Diane.
But the police soon learned that, unbeknownst to the agency, one of their own security managers had lured Karen Mandick to the house with the promise of a well-paid job. Karen had been working at the Fred Meyers department store. She was last seen driving her car to the house-sitting job. 18 hours later, the bodies of Karen Mandick and Diane Wilder were found in their car on this hillside overlooking Bellingham. They had been strangled.
There were no fingerprints in the vehicle. However, there were strangulation marks on the bodies. And at this point, it was decided to arrest the security guard. And this was a uniformed security guard. So arrangements were made with his boss to call him on the radio and have him dispatched to the South Terminal guard shack area, and we could arrest him there. As a uniformed security guard, he is armed, and this would be a much safer area for the police and everybody else to make an arrest of this type.
The man arrested was 27-year-old Kenneth Bianchi. He had left the Glendale area of Los Angeles a few months earlier and come to live here with his son and girlfriend Kelly Boyd.
The Ken I knew couldn't have ever hurt anybody or killed anybody.
What sort of person was he?
He was pretty thoughtful and real helpful with the baby, and even around the house he was real helpful. He just wasn't the kind of person that could have killed somebody.
My girlfriend and I went down to the security office here and applied for our job. And he was the first thing that we saw walk around the corner for our interview. And we both went, wow, look at that hunk. And when we went in for an interview, he was talking about his little boy and just a really nice guy. And then he came out to visit us a few times and helped us take down our tree and sent us flowers for Christmas. Just an all-around good guy.
To the lawyer appointed to defend him, Bianchi presented certain peculiarities.
He seemed pretty normal, but there were some things that didn't fit. He indicated he didn't know anything about the homicides, and yet he gave a series of increasingly incredible explanations of what he had been doing on the night of the murders. And so I checked out the psychiatric background by calling Don Lundy from Stanford Medical School.
Dr. Lundy was clinical associate professor of psychiatry and had been an expert witness in the Patty Hearst trial.
The thing that puzzled me was that there were some things he seemed not to remember or had different versions of, which had no relation to the crime. And the two that stand out the most in my mind are his description of his mother as a wonderful, saintly kind of woman, when I knew from records from childhood and so on that that was not the case. And secondly, the fact that he had no memory, he had a loss of memory, amnesia, as we would call it, for various events in his childhood, including periods when he was in psychiatric treatment. And so I was puzzled by this. But other than that, say, he seemed like a nice enough fellow.
This was how Bianchi came across to most of his interviewers.
I don't remember. I just asked that not too long ago. I seriously don't remember.
Can't remember what you ran the 100 in?
It could have been very good.
Oh, it might have been
I
good.
Really don't remember. I thought about it. No, I think it was more like 10-1, something like that.
Yes, good for high school.
10-1. I was always physically fit through high school, through college, always. Matter of fact, in college, I ran 2 to 3 miles every other day. I ran with a friend.
One of the original joggers.
Yeah, I just loved it. And
while psychiatrists continued to examine Bianchi, a Bellingham detective began telephone checks in Los Angeles because Bianchi had a California driver's license.
During that conversation, he related the facts of how their case occurred. Our investigator said, have you ever heard about the Hillside Strangler? He said, no, that he hadn't. He says, I think you've got something there awfully close to what we've been working on. Said he would get back to him. Subsequent to that, the investigator came to this machine, entered Kenneth Bianchi's name and his birth date, received this teletype from Department of Motor Vehicles, says Kenneth Felicio Bianchi, 809 East Garfield, Apartment D. Christina Weckler, one of the victims, lived in apartment C or E right next door at 809 East Garfield. Also, Cindy Hudspeth, our last victim, lived across the street at 800 East Garfield. With this teletype, we had tied him into two of the murders right away.
After 12 months, Los Angeles police had the break they'd been waiting for. But could they prove it? They went to Bellingham, where Bianchi had been charged with murder, even though police there still had no conclusive evidence. 4 weeks after Bianchi's arrest, officers Nolte and Knudsen revisited the house where they believed the two women had been killed, not so much by strangling, but by hanging.
This staircase here in the city of Bellingham on Edgemoor, after 4 or 5 weeks of working this house, is where we finally located the evidence that positively put the suspect with the two girls, and the homicide of the two girls occurred on this sixth step right here.
We discussed many times the method by which the girls were hung, and of course in a hanging there's a certain amount of violence, kicking, thrashing, and this residence had absolutely no sign of violence in it. There was no overturned furniture or anything, and the only place that it could logically have been done was within the stairwell. Fred and I came over and decided to start at the bottom of the stairwell and do a search, careful search for hairs and fibers. We spent 4 hours searching this stairwell. We started at the bottom with a bright light on our hands and knees and tweezers and worked our way up. When we got to the sixth step, we found a pubic hair. And when we got to approximately the ninth and tenth steps, we found long blonde and long dark haired. These hairs were later identified as belonging to our two victims, and the pubic hair was identified as belonging to Ken Bianchi. These hairs were the final piece of evidence that tied this case together for us. It put the cap on it. It was over. We were ready to go to court.
That must have been quite a day.
It was a hell of a day.
But did Bianchi also commit the Los Angeles murders? L.A. Detective Dudley Varney had his doubts. The methods of strangulation were different. The Bellingham bodies were clothed, and those in Los Angeles were naked. But Varney did bring back a set of Bianchi's fingerprints from Bellingham to compare with the prints found during the Los Angeles investigation. Still, there was no real reason to believe they would match.
This is the paw print of Kenneth Bianchi that was brought in by Dudley Varney. I immediately noticed, however, that he had a pattern in one of his fingers that we had been looking at for probably close to a year. So I immediately examined that one print. Here is an enlargement of the left ring finger of Kenneth Bianchi. The characteristics present in this latent fingerprint and the characteristics present in this exemplar matched, and from these characteristics I was able to make the identification. The more I began to look, the more things began to fall in, and before too much longer I was jumping around here like a ping pong ball. I was elated. It was unbelievable. 13 months of this kind of work and coming on to identifying a suspect on a case like this was just the greatest thrill of my life.
The police now felt that Bianchi was the Hillside Strangler and also had murdered the women in Bellingham. But had he acted alone?
We were looking for a co-conspirator on this series of crimes. We were looking for an associate. And our conversation with Kelly Boyd, we came up with one answer. The only person that Kenneth ran with was Angelo Bono. We said, well, who else does he see? Does he go out drinking with the boys at night or stop for a beer or play games or play baseball or anything? And she just shook her head and said, no, the only time he's away from home, he's with Angelo. He only has Angelo.
Angelo Bono was Kenneth Bianchi's cousin with whom he had lived when he first came to Los Angeles.
Bono was a hard-working, well-respected car upholsterer who had renovated many antique cars for show business personalities. There was nothing to link him with any of the murders, but the police put him under 24-hour surveillance. Back in Bellingham, despite the fingerprint evidence, Bianchi continued to insist on his innocence.
Between the publicity and the damage it's done to my family and to myself, and to a point of where my lawyer and I just couldn't see eye to eye because I knew what I had done, and I hadn't killed any girls.
But police evidence was so strong that Bianchi's lawyers began to investigate whether his failure to remember meant he had serious psychological problems. Investigation now focused not on his guilt, but on his state of mind. Dr. John Watkins, professor of psychology at the University of Montana, was asked by Bianchi's lawyers to use hypnosis to try to unblock Bianchi's memory. His arrival produced a sensational turning point in the case.
He seemed to be an easygoing, nice, friendly young man like the boy next door. He was much more concerned about what was happening inside of himself than he was in regards to what the law might do to him. He didn't believe he could possibly have done these crimes and refused to allow his attorney to plead an insanity defense. And I spent about the first hour getting acquainted with him.
Dr. Watkins visited Bianchi in the Bellingham jail. It was there that over 60 hours of interviews were eventually videotaped.
And we're going to be tape recording. Just a regular audio recording. And we also have some videotape here, which we may use later, and we'll use it only because it could be of help to you.
I can't tell you, I'm terrified about this whole thing.
And if you agree to it.
No, I don't mind.
Something inside of me was just boiling. I don't know why. I'm sorry I just ran out like that.
That's all right. That's all I can. I understand. I mean, I apologize.
Okay,
yeah.
Yes, I do.
Well, I'd like to try a little something to understand you better, okay?
Bianchi agreed to allow Dr. Watkins to hypnotize him in an attempt to restore his memory.
You were telling me that you were feeling very uncomfortable. I was sort of wondering why that feeling of uncomfortableness.
Over the next few weeks, in a series of interviews that usually, but not always, included hypnosis, something totally unexpected happened. Dr. Watkins began to uncover an astonishing and different side to Kenneth Bianchi.
I could know a little more why that uncomfortableness is there.
Yes, what?
Hello?
Hi.
Hi. Are you Ken?
Do I look like Ken?
Well, no. You know who I am?
Sure, I know you are.
Okay. You're good. You're a little disturbed with me.
So what?
Okay. We just understand each other. Okay.
I don't like you. I don't like you at all.
Well, why don't you like me again? I'm pardon me. It isn't Ken, is it?
No, it's not. It's Steve.
Oh, okay, Steve. This entity merged, and when I asked him who was Ken, he said, no, it's Steve. I then talked to Steve about his situation. He kept talking about how he hated that turkey, meaning Ken, and how he was fooling that turkey. He also began to talk about the murders, said that he had conducted the murders, that Ken didn't know anything about it, and he laughed very heartily as he described how Ken would lose a tremendous amount of time. He asked me, he said, how would you feel if you lost more time than a broken clock? He also began to mention about killing those girls down in Los Angeles.
Steve, the other personality, made a momentous confession. He admitted that he was the Hillside Strangler.
Yeah, I killed the first girl. You killed the first girl. You, who is she here? You know her? That nigger. Oh? Yeah. Of course. Nice black witch. I see. How did you happen to decide on her?
I must admit that I was quite surprised when this came out, because I had been thinking in terms of an amnesia, maybe only possibly a multiple personality, and only very possibly that he could be connected to the Hillside Strangler crimes.
Everyone had come to know Ken Bianchi, the all-American boy. Had Dr. Watkins' investigation uncovered another character, violent and horribly different from Ken? Psychiatrists had discovered in Ken Bianchi another horribly violent personality called Steve. And while Ken was under hypnosis, Steve came out and confessed that he was the Hillside Strangler. Multiple personality is a rare mental disorder made famous in the books Three Faces of Eve and Sybil, and the movies which followed. These were true stories of people in whom two or more personalities existed in the same body. The claim that Bianchi, like Eve, had more than one personality transformed the case.
In a true multiple personality, there are completely separate personalities within the same body. There may be two or three or four or more. Each one has its own identity. Each one has its own behaviors, its mannerisms, its speech. And when one is out, it may be completely unaware of the existence of the others.
In later interviews, Steve, Ken's other personality, went on to say he and his cousin Angelo committed the murders together.
Hey, man, it doesn't bother me any. I told you, killing a broad doesn't make any difference to me. Killing any fucking buddy doesn't make any difference.
Maybe you didn't kill any of those. I don't know.
Oh, hey, no, Rob, man. Hey, I killed a couple of these.
Well, which one? You think you did, right? I don't know.
I killed her. Angelo killed her.
They mean the Wagner one Angela killed.
This broad I'd never seen before.
Martin.
This broad I'd never seen before.
Hudspeth, you never saw them at all?
No.
Oh.
This broad I'd never seen before.
Robinson?
This broad I killed. These two Angelo killed.
Vector. Johnson.
This one I'd never seen before.
Angelo killed.
Huh? Now, this one I'd never seen before. This broad I killed.
Barcombe you never seen before. This Caston is the broad you killed, you say.
Am I going too fast?
Yeah, you're going too damn fast. I'm not that smart. Okay. I'm not bright as you are, so
since I enjoy your taste here and your interest, and I'm really, you know, very pleased that you take an interest in this, I'm going to do you a favor. Can you borrow your script here, okay?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, I'll do you a favor so that you don't get lost along the way.
Okay. All right. You do me the favor.
It's real easy.
Yeah.
What you understand is, this one I killed. These two I don't know about. This one I don't know about. This one I killed. This was the first one I killed.
No.
This one.
I remember that cunt.
Could she have worn her hair differently or something?
I don't know. Fucking remember. How would I know?
Angelo will be across, okay? I'll make it nice and easy for you. He's my kind of man.
Okay.
There should be more people in the world like Angelo.
All right, the ones that Angelo's across, and which ones are you then?
I'm the X's.
Oh, you're the X's.
Yeah, you want me to write that on top for you so you can remember?
Oh, don't you?
As psychiatrists in Bellingham continued to probe Ken Bianchi's mind, Angelo Bono in Los Angeles denied any involvement. There was no evidence against him except what Steve had said. The Los Angeles police had their own doubts about the value of the videotaped hypnosis sessions.
I almost threw up. I've seen hypnosis before. I've never seen anything quite like this. From that point on, it just looked like a sham.
I've still got my notebook where, after viewing the first tapes, I wrote in there, "This is bullshit," and underlined it 3 times.
And what was Ken Bianchi's reaction when he was finally shown the tapes?
Quite frankly, a little ways through the hypnosis session scared the hell out of me. I was just really surprised. You know, I just couldn't believe what I was seeing, and it just really bothered me really bad. I can't touch on all my feelings that I was having, but it just really bothered me. Matter of fact, I couldn't go any further part way through this one particular tape. And I stopped, and Dean talked to me, and John talked to me, and you know, they really helped a lot as far as, you know, putting some things in perspective and giving me support and things like that, you know, and reinforcing the feelings that I actually had, but I had buried, you know, to let these other feelings out when I was, you know, so disturbed by what I saw. So we finished watching the rest of that.
After viewing these tapes, Bianchi still said he could not remember the crimes and knew nothing of the personality called Steve. But for the first time, he did concede that his body must have done the murders. He entered an insanity defense before the Bellingham court on March 29, 1979. If successful, he could avoid the death penalty and perhaps eventually even win his freedom. The judge was faced with a dilemma. For 7 weeks, Bianchi had refused an insanity defense. Now he had changed his mind. A panel of experts was appointed. The question, was Bianchi truly a multiple personality? One of the experts was Dr. Ralph Allison, a psychiatrist in private practice in California and a leading authority on multiple personality.
The only thing I had to go on in any of this was matching him off against what I had come to know about the patients that I had treated myself. And there are 3 basic areas. One is a history, and one is his appearance right there in front of me. And the 3rd is certain psychological tests that you might apply. And certainly we had a good deal of history from him, psychological workups in his youth and doctor's reports, and it showed a tremendous amount of pathology and difficulty in the family. And all of this, you know, he was considered a very disturbed child.
We collected the psychiatric records of Ken Bianchi. To give you an example, he was trotted from doctor to doctor with a series of physical ailments. His eyes rolled, he had tics, he fell down, he had what they thought were petit mal seizures. And the doctor said, see a psychiatrist. His mother took him to the DePaul clinic, and these are quotes from their report. Quote, Dr. Dowling reported that Kenneth is a deeply hostile boy who has extremely dependent needs which his mother fulfills. He depends upon his mother for his very survival and expends a great deal of energy keeping his hostility under control and undercover. There seems some basic confusion about his own identity. He tries very hard to placate his mother, but she always seems dissatisfied. To sum up, Dr. Dowling said that he is a severely repressed boy who is very anxious and very lonely. Now, I then contacted the psychologist who wrote that report when he was 11 years old. He responded, in my opinion, the psychological test data from 1962, when he was 11, are quite consistent with a subsequent condition of multiple personality.
During our interviews of the people that knew Bianchi, his co-workers, his friends, relatives, kid that he'd grown up with, at no time were we able to come up with a personality change or a mood change.
He's a very, very smart man. And I believe to him this is a challenge. I believe that he is playing a role and playing a part. I think it's part of his ego. I think he feeds his ego with it. And he's having the ball.
We didn't rely just on the records. We found, for example, in his basement, this statue. This was traced to a high school sculpture class. Now remember, the psychologist reported that he told them fun for him was playing games, scary games, in which he was the monster. And this is the product of his sculpture.
The mother had been recommended for therapy. The child had been recommended for therapy. Neither one had gone, so we knew no resolution had occurred. And then I did a hypnosis and tried to carry him back in time to see what kind of specific difficulties occurred between him and his mother.
When I stop at a certain age, I want you to feel as you were at that age, not as you think you should have been or what you hoped you might have been, but as you really were, and being able then to talk to me about whatever kind of problems occurred to you at that age, as if you are, you know, going through those problems very recently, but are now able to express them to me as if I was a counselor there for you at that time. I'll just count backwards slowly, and you allow your mind to gear into those age states as you get younger. 27, go down to 26, 25, 11, 10, and 9. I'm going to talk to the 9-year-old Ken in any way that is comfortable for you. Being 9 years old, being aware of me, not being bothered by anything else, not being upset about what's in the surroundings, I'd like you to be the 9-year-old Ken telling me about what kind of important things have been going on with you in recent days. What's been going on, Ken?
I've been playing. Been a lot of fights between my mom and dad.
Well,
mom hits me a lot.
Mom hits you?
And he was a very lonely child. He felt that his mother kept his playmates away. He was the victim of her anger at her husband, who was going out to the racetracks and losing a family paycheck. So she took it out on her son because husband wasn't there.
I don't want to get hit. When I do what I want to do, I get hit. I don't want to get hit anymore. She hits my dad, she hits me.
Where are you living now?
Big green house.
On what street?
Villa Street.
What town?
Rochester, New York.
How old are
you? Just turning 9.
How do you celebrate your 9th birthday?
I thought I'd have a cake and a lot of friends over, and Mom got mad at me. I didn't have any of my friends over. I was going to have a party, and there was no party.
Where do you hide?
Under my bed, in my closet, behind the house. The bed's the best place.
Do you hide inside your own head?
Sometimes, just to get away.
What do you do in there?
Talk.
Anybody else here to talk to?
My friend.
Who's that?
Stevie. He's my second best buddy.
Is that a last name?
He did have a last name.
What was it?
I can't remember.
Well, what's the
Walker.
Name? Walker. Well, where did he get that name? Do you know his parents?
He didn't have any parents. Stevie was alone.
Yeah, this is characteristic of multiple personalities because they just cannot run away physically. So they run away inside their minds. They create somebody who does the escape or handles it. It would seem that Ken coped with this by a process of denying that problems really occurred, that denying that his mother was being so hard on him. She was, in his mind, a very loving person, and he manufactured this fantasy, but that didn't follow through. Then he would repress his feelings of anger toward her, bury them in his mind somewhere, and this then would be walled off from the rest of his mind as a sewer. That's what would later erupt. But at the time he was a child, he would pour more and more of his hostility, resentment toward her into this portion of his mind where he could store it up. Eventually it would erupt. And when it erupted, these women got killed. They were raped and then killed. So I wrote a report to the judge stating my opinion. This is what I said to him. Said he is a dual personality and has been so since the age of 9. At that time, he created an alter personality which took the name of Steve Walker. This was while he was hiding under the bed in his bedroom trying to escape his mother's vicious tongue and punishing hand. As time elapsed, Steve Walker became more and more independent in action and was able to take over the body of Kenneth Bianchi and caused a great deal of trouble in the family and later in the world outside the family. Then I concluded that Ken Bianchi is able to understand what he is charged with, but he has amnesia for the actual incidences during which his body was under the control of Steve Walker. Therefore, he has not been able to discuss his whereabouts, actions, and motives with his attorney, since all of that time is completely unknown to him. Steve Walker, on the other hand, does not consider Mr. Brett to be his attorney. Therefore, at the present time, I would not consider Ken Bianchi or Steve Walker competent to stand trial for the crimes charged. And that's what I reported to the judge.
But the Bellingham investigators were not impressed by the videotaped interviews, and even less impressed by Dr. Allison.
When he first came here and we were waiting to start a session, we were standing around outside the area talking, and he indicated that it was very important to him to establish this multiple personality because he was close to a world record number of fines of multiple personalities, and he was in writing a book or had a book going on this topic. And I felt that it was more important to him that the multiple personality be found than, in my mind, the facts of the case be brought forth.
The Los Angeles police never had the opportunity to talk to the Steve personality, so they decided to take Ken back to Los Angeles, to the streets from which the victims had been abducted, to retrace the steps of each crime. While they were doing this, Bianchi began to remember more about the murders than he had so far admitted to the doctors.
A couple of things that he told us about became very important in the case. One of the incidents was an incident involving Kathy Lurie. Kathy Lurie is a young daughter of Peter Lurie, a very famous Hollywood actor. Bianchi told us of this incident where they had stopped her on the streets in Hollywood a short distance from here around the time of the Judy Miller abduction, and using police badges, they had stopped her and told her that they were police officers. After asking her for identification, she presented a wallet. In the wallet, along with her identification, was a photograph of her as a youngster on her father's knee. And anybody that's grown up in this area or familiar with movies recognize Peter Lorre. Discretion, the better part of valor. They decided they'd back off this one and let her go.
She subsequently ended up taking us to the location where the incident that Bianchi related to us had occurred, and she described it exactly the way Bianchi described it.
As far as I know, they were laughing at us behind our backs. They thought Bianchi was just putting on a real great show for us and leading us down the primrose path. They didn't understand how we could be fooled so easily, I think.
But do you feel that it's a difficult condition to understand?
Very difficult. I mean, we were trying to find out how these different sections of his mind were operating, and in the process, there had to be a leakage from one to the other. We could not help that. And when there's a leakage, then there's a change in the status. The part that didn't know about things now knew about things.
So that means he can change from month to month?
That means he can change from day to day. And there was at least one point where he had a major change where one night a lot of awareness of the crime suddenly came into his mind. He became acutely suicidal. He called for his lawyer. They had a meeting, and he calmed down. From then on, he had no doubt he had done the crime. And he certainly was a great deal different to an examiner because he didn't deny it anymore.
In July 1979, 6 months after his arrest, Ken Bianchi, as Ken, began to remember the Los Angeles murders. Without hypnosis, he described them to Dr. Lundy.
And then they were brought into, all the killings occurred in the spare room, next to the bathroom.
Wait a minute, we skipped the sex here.
We're not there yet.
Oh, okay. Hands are tied, and then they're taken to...
Hands are tied, and then they're taken into the spare room next to the bathroom. That's when there was sex with the girls. After that, they were untied, allowed to dress themselves, tied up again, and they sat back on the bed. And meanwhile, everything was made ready. They were then.
What did that involve?
Getting the rope to kill them with.
Okay.
Or whatever.
Okay.
I can't believe I'm talking about this. That's come a long way, Dr. Lundy.
Four experts now agreed Bianchi was insane, and the county prosecutor feared he could go free.
I was very concerned. I spoke to the defense attorney, and he's a person I've worked with on many cases, and he's a very straightforward attorney. And he was absolutely convinced that Mr. Bianchi was a multiple personality and felt that he could actually convince me of that. And he believed that he would be acquitted by reason of insanity. That concerned me a great deal because that meant he would be out on the streets if he could just convince a number of psychiatrists that he was cured of his problem, which I felt he could easily do.
So how did you handle this?
We sought an expert in hypnosis, and we obtained a worldwide recognized expert, Dr. Orne.
Dr. Martin Orne is professor of psychology and psychiatry at the University of Pennsylvania. Could he shed new light on Kenneth Bianchi?
He seems like a pleasant, cooperative individual, but whenever I see an individual in a forensic situation, somebody accused of premeditated murder facing a death penalty, I always have to ask myself, is this individual telling me how he really feels, or is he malingering or faking? Because after all, there's a tremendous motivation to appear insane and that way not be responsible for the things he did. And so that before you can make a diagnosis, well, I have to decide whether he is for real.
I've met Ken, but I haven't met Steve yet. So I'd like to meet Steve for a bit. What do you want? I'd like to talk to you. I want a fucking cigarette. Give me a cigarette.
During hypnosis, Steve appeared for Dr. Orne as he had for Drs. Watkins and Allison. But this time, there was a new surprise. Other personalities also appeared.
I knew that he had been appointed by the prosecuting attorney, and the hopes were that he would demolish the insanity defense by showing no evidence of a multiple personality. And here I saw the personalities laid out. Ken was there, and clearly... Steve came out, and then we had this little boy that was a scared little kid. And I thought, my goodness, Dr. Orne's now on the side of truth and justice. You know, he will now be able to testify that he's got multiple personalities. So I was very happy with it. I thought it was a very good presentation.
But Dr. Orne thought there was another possibility. Bianchi could be faking. before and asked Bianchi directly.
You have to recognize, given your ability and your motivation, the possibility of your using a multiple personality, perhaps even using some of the psychiatrists, psychologists who saw you, to your own ends, has to be considered very seriously.
Sure, absolutely.
And I don't think it has been considered thus far. How do I know that you didn't kind of cook this?
Although Dr. Orne was skeptical, the other psychiatrists were convinced that Bianchi was insane. The police were equally convinced that Bianchi had fooled the experts.
How do you resolve it then?
They feared that two mass murderers, Bianchi and his cousin Angelo Bono, could go free. There was no doubt Ken Bianchi was a killer. But was he insane, a multiple personality, or was he faking to avoid the death penalty? The prosecution pinned its hopes on Dr. Martin Orne, professor of psychology and psychiatry at the University of Pennsylvania. Before interviewing Bianchi further, he decided to look at the increasingly bizarre findings of police investigations into Bianchi's past.
Especially in a first-degree murder case, I feel I cannot rely on what the defendant says without corroboration. So I insisted on getting all of the police records and comparing this with what he said to all of us. And it led to some very interesting data. For example, there was a interaction between Angelo and Mr. Bianchi, which must have been truly memorable with an individual that occurred several years before he was arrested.
That individual was Tiny Boyles, a 440-pound, 6-foot bodyguard. Some years before, Tiny had run across Bianchi and Angelo Bono. His meeting was to become significant in Dr. Orne's investigation because Tiny had discovered that Bianchi was not quite the all-American boy he seemed.
But you do know that they were running a ring of prostitution and using young girls, exploiting them, the best I could find out in my investigation, they were using them for blackmail.
Tiny learned that while Bianchi and Bono were running their ring of underage prostitutes, they had a conflict with one of their clients, a Los Angeles lawyer, which supposedly had escalated to a point where the cousins had threatened to kill the lawyer. The lawyer responded by sending Tiny Boyles and four of his friends over to reason with Bianchi and Bono.
Bono was working on a car detailing it. And I kept talking to him, he kept ignoring me. So I reached in the window and jerked him out through the window so fast, so hard, he left his shoes in there. And while I had him up in the air, I asked him if he'd all mind paying attention to me. So while I was dangling him in the air, he paid full attention, so I lowered him back down on the ground. And I gave him one of the lawyer's cards, and I told him, I said, don't be offering to kill him no more, because the last thing in the world you want is an instant replay of me.
So how did Bono react to that?
He told me there'd be no more troubles.
And what about Bianchi?
Bianchi is a little sniveling poo butt. But he was what you call the doc, what we call the perverted doc. His job was, if girls were scared of snakes, he put snakes on them. He done that to make sure they brought the money home. He worked on their morbid fears. And he run behind his security door, which he'd already knew who we were, what we were. And he's behind his door, holding the security door, sniveling. Please don't hurt me. Please don't hurt me. Well, we knew they were into something heavy, but we didn't know what. But if I'd have known it was killing those little young girls, one of those girls was, 13, 14 years old? If I'd have known it, I got four daughters of my own, I'd have snapped their neck like a twig and not had no remorse for it.
Dr. Orne decided that this encounter was important enough to ask Bianchi if he could remember Tiny and his friends.
Yeah, but I understand that the whoever it was got five tough, big guys to
foot with you. Reasonable if you have this foot.
No, you got the wrong person. Angelo.
Oh.
They visited Angelo, Sean.
I see, but they...
They were bikers. They're called bike motorcyclists from a local bike club.
Uh-huh.
They visited Angelo, Sean.
Yeah, but they came... Look, you know, I wasn't there, but I understand they came to see you also, and you kind of got away just as they were coming. I'm trying to think back, because that must have been a very impressive group.
Mr. Bianchi's not remembering an event which is very memorable is very telling. Either he is giving me a barefaced lie, and he's been accused of being a pathological liar by many people, or the same thing could be explained by his being multiple personality and really not knowing. And the problem is to distinguish between these two possibilities. The behavior could be explained in both ways.
While Dr. Oren was beginning to probe Kenneth Bianchi's mind, the police continued to look into his past. In Los Angeles, police found a psychologist, Charles Weingarten. He told of meeting a Kenneth Bianchi who claimed to be a psychologist also.
He wanted to rent office space from me. He said that he was desperate for some space, and I told him we weren't renting, but I would let him use the office for a couple of weeks so he could find permanent space. He was very appropriate when he came in. He smiled easily. He talked well about transactional analysis, which is the kind of therapy that he said he used. We talked a little about that.
How did he present himself?
He was very well dressed. He appeared to be intelligent. He sounded that way. He commented on my diplomas and licenses, my business card, the type of practice that I had. He asked appropriate questions.
So what do you feel in retrospect?
It was a good con.
The two things that Bianchi was most interested in was, one, the business card, and two, were some plaques he had on the wall, permaplaques of his degrees. Well, shortly after Bianchi surfaces up in Bellingham, we discovered that Bianchi had such plaques. Here's photographs of them. Trustees of Columbia University confer on Kenneth Alessio Bianchi a Master of Science degree in psychology. Another one, Certificate of Accomplished Kenneth A. Bianchi, intern in residence, Strong Memorial Hospital in New York. And an interesting one here is an institution or an association that doesn't even exist, the National Psychiatric Association of America, Kenneth A. Bianchi, Doctor of Psychiatry.
We came across a handwritten flyer that he had been putting under the windshield wipers of cars parked in the neighborhood. He had the date October, November of 76 on the bottom of this thing with a copy of his graduation picture, presumably. It read, "Dear neighbor, hi, first let me introduce myself. My name is Ken Bianchi. I'm a 74 graduate of Columbia University, served an internship at a major New York hospital, and over 2 years of private practice." He then goes on to state that for the nominal fee of $10, you can mail him 5 questions or problems, and send your question or problem along with your age, sex, first initial and last name, and a check or money order to cover the fee, and that he will return an answer as soon as possible. And we had a budding neighborhood, Dear Abby, there in Glendale.
There's several parts to the diploma thing.
Mm-hmm.
I was aware that they did exist. However, to me, they were just a novelty item.
It was clear that both the diplomas and the counseling service were phony. But was this the work of Steve? Had he taken over? Was Ken only now beginning to remember Steve's actions? It could be read that way. Dr. Oren went to the Bellingham jail in May 1979 in an attempt to find out if Kenneth Bianchi was a genuine multiple personality or not.
I had an unusual opportunity because Mr. Bianchi had worked with two great authorities on multiple personality, and Dr. Allison had tried to bring out another personality and failed. This gave me the possibility of doing exactly what Dr. Allison had done in hypnosis, where I knew he wasn't going to come out with another personality. There's no reason why he should. But to add one thing, that is, in the wake state, to give him a hint that his interests would be best served if he brought out an extra personality, because every multiple typically has three or more. And if he was malingering or faking, then he'd grab onto that hint, and when later hypnotized, he was going to bring out one, two, or three extra personalities.
In this videotape, Bianchi is not yet hypnotized. Dr. Orne will quietly drop the hint that genuine multiples usually have more than two personalities.
I was told that there was a possibility that I had what's called a multiple personality, which means that there are two separate distinct personalities within the same body, I guess.
And it's very rare for there to be two, actually. That's one of the things I'm curious about.
Yeah, they mentioned only the two. I don't know. I really don't know that much about the field. It's just as new to me as it is to, you know, a lot of other people.
All right. As I say, one, you'll grow deeper, you'll sink deeper, and you'll become aware of it happening. It will not be frightening to you because you know I'm here and you're safe.
Later that day, Dr. Orne put Bianchi to the test. Under hypnosis, Orne asked whether there were any other personalities whom he and the other psychiatrists had not met. Would Bianchi take the hint?
And as I talk to you now, that part of you which has not talked to anyone, that is not Ken, and that is not Steve, may come forth. What is your name?
Billy.
All right, Billy. Tell me, what do you know about Kent?
Ken. I don't know Ken.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And what is your last name?
I don't know.
Mm-hmm. And how about Steve?
I know Steve.
Mm-hmm. Do you like Steve?
He's a bad egg.
Doctors Watkins and Allison applauded Dr. Orne's success in bringing out this new personality. Had he succeeded where they had failed?
Well, actually, I mimicked the approaches which they took. And if you don't notice the little hint which I gave that every multiple personality typically has three, and you overlook that, then it certainly appears as if I did a better job than they did, because the path came out for me and it hadn't for them. But that's because of what I said in the wake state, not what I said in hypnosis.
So you mean Mr. Bianchi just picked it up because it would make him more credible?
That's the way I interpret it, exactly.
If Bianchi was faking multiple personality, was he also faking hypnosis? This was an important issue for the police. Under California law, a witness who has been hypnotized cannot testify in court because hypnosis changes memory. If Kenneth Bianchi really was hypnotized, he could not testify against Angelo Bono.
We've done a lot of work about the faking of hypnosis and found, to our surprise, that even the world's outstanding hypnotists could not identify people who were untrained faking hypnosis. After a while, we began to develop criteria, and we've done a lot of work in finding things which separate people who are faking from those who are not. I asked him to hallucinate. Mr. Brett, his attorney, a good subject, would be able to do that with no difficulty, and indeed he apparently hallucinates Mr. Brett.
As you open your eyes, there's a chair in front of you, a chair with armrests, where Mr. Brett will be sitting, and you will be able to see him clearly in front of you. Open your eyes and look at Mr. Brett. He wants to talk to you.
Hey, Dean, how you doing? What's new?
I'll leave you to talk to him for a few moments. I'll be back.
Okay.
Your wife have the baby yet? No, not yet. Okay. So what's new? What are we going to talk about, the three of us?
Well, I want you to describe Dean to me in some detail. What is his... Is he shaving?
Oh, no. His beard? Mm-hmm. God, you can see him. Mm-hmm. You must be able to see him. His hair isn't combed as usual.
First of all, his spontaneously getting up and shaking the hand is something which you never see with deeply hypnotized subjects. I've never seen any subject do this spontaneously, because when you shake somebody's hand, that's a tactile hallucination which you have to have, and it makes it much more difficult, and people don't volunteer this unless they're asked to do it. Even more striking, though, is what he does when I ask him to describe Dean Brett. He says, "You see him. You must see him. He's there. You must see him." Now, that's an overplaying. Shakespeare would say, "Methinks he doth protest too much."
You're not talking to some fucking dummy. You understand?
Dr. Oren also studied what happened when Ken's second personality, Steve, appeared. He examined the videotapes of the other psychiatrists and was intrigued by Steve's behavior.
I think you're so fucking smart.
At one point, Steve comes out, and Steve hears the tips off the cigarettes, and he smokes the unfiltered pot. When Ken comes back, he begins to talk, and he notices this, and he says, "Who would put filter tips here? Why are those filter tips here? How did those filter tips get there?" Now, a subject might ask once, "How come those filter tips are there?" But, you know, he goes on, and he kind of, again, protests too much. He's rubbing in the fact that he does know how those filter tips get there to demonstrate to either Dr. Allison or Dr. Watkins, he does the trick with both of them, in order to prove to them that he really has had an issue.
And there's the other cigarette you just finished. I don't smoke.
Where's the filter, Dr.?
I can't. Broke it off. Don't you break off filters?
No, I can't smoke a non-filter cigarette.
Well, what happened here? The smoke without the filter on it? Is that right?
That's right.
Mm-hmm. I guess somebody around here smokes without a filter. You ever found that before?
Yeah.
Where and when?
At home. Different times, you know, around apartments I've had.
Mm-hmm.
I thought maybe it broke and I put it into the ashtray and after
doesn't
I...
Doesn't look like that.
No, I think so.
As if he thought that the experts were all kind of thick and he's got to really rub it in so they should understand it. By the same token, he picks up on cues. When he is asked whether he had ever seen those filter tips around, he thinks for a while and then out he comes. "Yes, of course, I saw them and they puzzled me. I didn't know what they were," and he describes this. The catch is his wife never reports anything of that kind. No one has ever seen anything of that sort. There's absolutely no corroboration. Furthermore, he's seen Three Faces of Eve, the film, which is like an education in how to fake a multiple personality. And a lot of other data, which is in the police records and in the interviews, convince me that this man is faking a multiple personality and he's faking a person.
I was flabbergasted. I felt that totally surprised that after... his particular interviews, he came out with an exactly opposite conclusion from what I saw in observing his tapes.
What in particular in his tapes confirmed your diagnosis?
The behavior of Bianchi in going into hypnosis and coming out, the inductions that were used by Oren were very typical of hypnotized subjects. The personalities that came out showed the same clear-cut differences that they did when they came out for me.
The controversy continued. Was Bianchi insane or was he faking? If he were insane, he could not testify against his cousin, Angelo Bono. With no hard evidence to arrest Bono, police feared he would go free. Was Ken Bianchi really insane, or was he faking both hypnosis and a multiple personality? As psychiatric experts disagreed about Bianchi's state of mind, police investigation focused on a letter written before Bianchi's arrest and found in his clothing after he was jailed. The letter was signed Thomas Stephen Walker, the name of Ken's second personality. And to the defense, it was more evidence that Steve was really taking over Ken Bianchi's life.
We found that as something that might verify the existence of Steve Walker, Watkins' multiple personality, Steve Walker.
Were you excited when that time?
Yes, that was a favorable thing.
The police saw this very differently. They still did not believe Steve had been taking over Ken's body, and they were curious to know where the name Steve Walker had come from. They visited Valley College in Los Angeles, where they came up with an explanation that dramatically changed the picture.
These university records in the name of Kenneth A. Bianchi, retrieved at the time of his arrest in the state of Washington, turned out to be our best piece of evidence against the multiple personality. These indicate that Bianchi attended three universities here in the state of California, and ultimately graduating with a master's degree in psychology. At the time of their discovery, we didn't feel that they were authentic due to the education starting in 73, which was a period of time when we knew for a fact he was still living in Rochester, New York. In coming here to Valley College, we gave them to the supervising clerk, and she indicated to us upon first glance that they were a forgery due to the date of birth of the actual student being coded into the transcript and not corresponding to the date of birth that Bianchi put in being his own.
If the university records were forged, who did the originals belong to? They were traced to a young psychology graduate, Thomas Stephen Walker, whose transcripts had been stolen by Bianchi. Bianchi then adopted Stephen Walker as the name of his supposed second personality. He took the university records, substituted Thomas Stephen Walker's name with his own, and then forged Walker's signature to get further records from the university. This was the piece of evidence the police were waiting for.
The impact was that it broke the multiple personality defense. We were able to prove and document the fact that Thomas Stephen Walker really did exist, and it was not an alter ego of Kenneth Bianchi. And because of that, Bianchi subsequently changed his plea.
This morning, a sensational break in the Hillside Strangler case. Bianchi entered the Whatcom County Superior Court amid tight security. Sitting in the packed courtroom was Bianchi's common law wife, Kelly Boyd.
Faced with the compelling police evidence on Stephen Walker, and with Dr. Orne's investigation that cast grave doubts on the psychiatric evidence, Kenneth Bianchi withdrew his plea of not guilty by reason of insanity. In a plea bargain, the state of Washington dropped its demand for the death penalty in exchange for an agreement from Bianchi to plead guilty to the Bellingham murders and to testify against Angelo Bono in Los Angeles.
Bianchi, who had wept openly during much of the hour-long proceeding, was asked if he had anything to say before the sentence was passed.
Your Honor, I can't find the words to express the sorrow I feel for what I've done. In no way can I take away the pain that I've given to others. And in no way can I expect forgiveness from anybody.
After the hearing, Bianchi was flown to Los Angeles to be arraigned with the Hillside Strangler murders. Although formally charged with the same 10 deaths as Angelo Bono, he will plead guilty to 5 of them and receive life sentences in both states. The deal is that Kenneth Bianchi will be spared the death penalty on condition that he testifies against his cousin, Angelo Bono.
Bono was taken into custody earlier yesterday after being arrested at his home in Glendale. Prosecutors now have some evidence linking 45-year-old Angelo Bono to the Hillside Strangler murders, but they do not think this evidence is enough without the testimony of his cousin. The fate of Angelo Bono now rests on the credibility of Kenneth Bianchi as a witness.
Kenneth Bianchi's state of mind became the central legal question in Los Angeles. No court had yet ruled on his sanity or whether he had truly been hypnotized. If he was insane, or if he had been hypnotized, he would be unable to testify against Angelo Bono. An alleged mass murderer might go free. As court hearings on Bianchi's sanity approached, Dr. Orne consulted Dr. Margaret Singer, a professor of psychology at the University of California in Berkeley.
From childhood on, Mr. Bianchi's history is that of a typical psychopath. Even his own mother said that he lied. And he has a history of lifelong, almost pointless lying, which is the mark of a psychopathic kind of habitual lying, that it's easier to lie than to tell the truth. And the lying is done usually just to try to persuade a person or to make the psychopath feel better at the moment.
While Bianchi was in jail, he sent almost 50 love letters to a young woman he had known in Bellingham. Dr. Singer saw these letters as evidence of the lies and manipulative charm of a psychopath. They were addressed to hairdresser Angie Kinneberg.
He seemed interested in what I was doing with myself, and he was honest with me, concerned, and very convincing, even in his writing. I believed anything he said to me, and he told me he was innocent. He once said that he wished it would be like a Perry Mason movie, where in the end someone would stand up and say they were with him in the night of question. And in the meantime, after he got arrested, I received some letters. Like on February 2nd, it says, "If I can't account for the time between 8:10 and 9:50, I'm probably going to die in the gas chamber because of what someone else did. If only I had come over to see you, I would have had an alibi that would save my life." On February 8th, it says, "I wish there was someone who was with me that January 11th night from around 8 till almost 10 p.m., someone who can give a statement to that effect and swear to it." On February 25th, "Dean came in this morning and said that if you don't come forward before February 28th, you can never come forward in my behalf. I told him you feared for your life. He said, without your testimony, I was sunk."
Why did you make it?
I read between the lines, and I decided that he wanted me to write an alibi for him, which I did. And why? I sent it to him in jail.
What was going through your mind?
Well, at first I thought, how could this person do anything wrong? I figured if he could get out of jail, he could prove himself. But I wrote to him saying where we were, what I was wearing, and all these things. And after I sent it to him, a couple days later, I decided I can't do this. This is all wrong. So I decided to tell him, just get rid of him. Then a couple days later, his lawyer called me and asked to have a talk with me. So I went and spoke to him, and he said that if I went along with it, I would be an accessory to the fact. I already told him, though, that I'd told Ken to get rid of the letter.
How did Ken take it?
The last time I got to see him was to tell him that I decided not to do it. And he said, whatever you feel is best.
Angie Kinneberg still writes me now and again, and she has this fantasy love affair going with me, even though there's never been anything between us. It has been something that has grown and grown. I mean, Teresa, I don't have all the letters. I've destroyed a lot of them because they're just, but I mean, it's just grown into such a fantastic one-sided love affair. She's just madly in love. She signs her letters now, "I love you very much."
Angie was only one. There were 12 other alibis. Psychopaths never quit. For example, he had asked his mother to type an alibi letter for him with rubber gloves on so there'd be no fingerprints on it, and would she fly to Seattle, Washington, still with rubber gloves and mail it so that that would establish an alibi. He also tried to blame the murders up in Washington on Greg, a dead motorcyclist whom he knew was dead. He also tried to get a copycat killer, namely a woman that he induced to go and attempt to duplicate the murders to be an alibi for him. He convinced another woman to confess for him. The psychopaths just don't stop. They don't give up. They continue the same style.
Is he sane?
Yes, he's sane. He knew the difference between right and wrong. He was able to form the intent for the murders, and they were highly planned and organized murders both before and afterwards. He is sane in the eyes of the law. The general public may think that this is crazy behavior. It is outrageous behavior, but in the eyes of the law, it is sane.
Dr. Singer got unexpected support for her opinion. The night before he was to be cross-examined in Bianchi's sanity hearing, Dr. Ralph Allison, who had left private practice to become a prison psychiatrist, said he had changed his mind about Bianchi. Experience in prison opened his eyes.
Well, I quickly learned, working here with inmates, that I had no reason to believe anything they said. That was a shock to me because I had been used to believing what my patients told me and working from that. But here I would meet a man as he's trying to go on parole, and I find out that he's told one story when he got arrested to the police, another story to his own attorney, a third story when he got into court, a fourth story to his parole officer, and a fifth story to me when I got him here. And now he wants to go on parole, and he's got a sixth story. And there's no way, you know, that you can tell what's the truth when you have that kind of changing history.
Despite Dr. Allison's change of mind, four experts still believed Bianchi was insane. Was he really smart enough to fake both hypnosis and a complex disorder like multiple personality? The police believed he was.
After learning about Kenneth Bianchi's psychological defense, we happened to be in his home serving a search warrant in Bellingham when we discovered these books in the home. Some of the books were found in the upstairs in the bookshelf, and some of them were found in the basement in boxes. Among these books were a dictionary of behavioral science, psychoanalysis of behavior therapy, psychology, behavioral therapy, modern clinical psychology, diagnostic psychological testing, hypnotic techniques, elements of psychology, supervision of police personnel, infant psychiatry, criminal procedure law, and juvenile delinquency.
So what did all this suggest to you?
Well, as a layman, finding these books in Kenneth Bianchi's home, I had to believe that he had either some background or knowledge in psychology or the behavioral sciences.
He's a wannabe doctor or a wannabe psychologist, and he had that background. And I think when he got stuck in a corner up there and looked like he was going to fry, he went back to the thing he probably knew the best, and that was the psychiatric thing.
The hearings to decide if Bianchi faked were held before Judge Ronald George of the Los Angeles Superior Court. The judge personally viewed over 60 hours of videotape, heard the experts cross-examined, and delivered his judgment on November 3rd, 1981.
My judgment was that Bianchi faked both the hypnosis and the multiple personality, and I came to that conclusion based on the circumstantial evidence acquired by the police, the contradictory testimony of Bianchi with regard to his mental status, and the opinions voiced by the psychiatrist who examined him. Now, the circumstantial evidence, of course, involved the feigned Steve Walker personality, the books on hypnosis, psychiatry, in psychology, the psychology counseling service, and the lack of any history, of course, of amnesia, multiple personality, and so forth, and the viewing of Sybil and Three Faces of Eve and the reading of the book in that regard. Now, the physicians had very different techniques. I was impressed by Dr. Orne's credentials and his methodology. He relied on logic and on the circumstantial evidence, on the history of Bianchi, and did not ask us to accept his opinion merely on the basis of authority. On the contrary, Dr. Watkins, I thought, was incredibly naive in making certain assumptions that Mr. Bianchi would not malinger and that he was, in fact, telling the truth on all occasions.
The judge, in his summing up, said you were, and I quote, incredibly naive. Why do you think he said that?
Well, it's very difficult for judges and lawyers to believe in the reality of multiple personality, especially when many psychologists and psychiatrists themselves don't believe in that reality. And judges do tend to be incredibly naive psychologically, even as I am very naive in legal matters.
But he seems to be saying you've ignored a lot of factual evidence.
I had all the evidence that was given by all the examinations, and I didn't see the evidence as being factual at all. They simply reported that this body known as Bianchi did certain things at certain times, but in no way could they show whether it was Steve or Ken that was the executive personality at that time.
In November 1981, Angelo Bono was finally put on trial for murder. The star witness was his cousin Kenneth Bianchi. During 80 days on the stand, Bianchi constantly changed his story. One day he said he was responsible for a murder, the next day he said Angelo did it. But the prosecution did not have to rely on Bianchi alone. The lengthy evaluation of fibers found in Bono's shop was now complete. Those fibers matched fibers found on the eyelids of one of the victims. Fibers found on this chair matched those found on the wrists of another victim, Lauren Wagner, who had been tortured with electric shocks before she was strangled.
Department 123 of the Superior Court of the State of California for the County of Los Angeles is now in session.
On January 9th, 1984, the longest criminal trial in American history came to an end. Kenneth Bianchi had already escaped the death penalty by agreeing to testify against his cousin. Apparently, the jury felt it unfair to request the death penalty for Angelo Bono. He was given life without possibility of parole. And the judge had this to say about Kenneth Bianchi.
Mr. Bianchi had faked memory loss, he had faked hypnosis, and he had faked multiple personalities. This action by Mr. Bianchi caused confusion and delay in the proceedings. In this, Mr. Bianchi was unwittingly aided and abetted by most of the psychiatrists who naively swallowed Mr. Bianchi's story, hook, line, and sinker, almost confounding the criminal justice system. I'm sure, Mr. Bono and Mr. Bianchi, that you will both probably only get your thrills reliving over and over again the tortures and murders of your victims, being incapable, as I believe you to be, of ever feeling any remorse.
Ken Bianchi was sentenced to life imprisonment. Although technically eligible for parole, no one believes it will ever be granted. And the final diagnosis on Kenneth Bianchi?
Mr. Bianchi is a sexual psychopath. What is wrong is that the sexual impulse becomes twisted and fused with violence so that the individual derives sexual satisfaction from the violence around a murder.
And what creates such a psychopath?
Science really doesn't know. There may be genetic and environmental influences intermingling. We don't really know for sure. He may simply be evil.
Kenneth Bianchi is now serving concurrent life sentences in Walla Walla State Prison in Washington State.
We'll have a 3 or 4 minute breather tonight before we present the next program, Fortunes of War, the story of Guy and Harriet based on Olivia Manning's story of a marriage and wartime. World War II is next. Tonight's story, Inside the Mind of a Murderer, will be presented again next Monday evening at 11 o'clock. And Frontline, next in the series about Your Flight is Canceled, the story of flight delays, tomorrow evening.